Thomas Baldrick here at ASCO 2015. Having with us now is Dr. Bernardo Rapoport from the Medical Oncology Center of Rosebank in South Africa. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
So we're looking at chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting and the role and the impact of rolapentin. First of all, tell us about this particular drug.
This particular drug is an NK1 receptor antagonist, which is basically NK1 is involved on the pathogenesis of a delayed phase of chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting. This drug has been researched recently, and there were a number of pivotal trials looking at highly emetogenic chemotherapy, or HEC, and moderately emetogenic chemotherapy. There have been three studies, two on the HEC, highly emetogenic, and one on the MEC. Now, the current study was looking at the quality of life of the patients during chemotherapy treatment, looking particularly at the impact of chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting in the quality of life of the patients.
What methods did you use in the study?
Well, the data from the three, or the patient population from the three, the two HECs, or highly emetogenic chemotherapy and the moderately emetogenic chemotherapy, data was put it all together, and they look at the quality of life of the patients, looking basically at the functional living index of MSEs, which comprises of questions related to nausea, how did it influence the quality of life, and questions related to vomiting also. And then the patients give a score of up to 7, and then if the score is more than 108, it's no impact on quality of life, while if it's less, is affecting the quality of life of the patients. And to cut a very long story short, the patients that were treated on the rolapentin arm, now the study consisted of the standard of care at the time of the designing of the study was two drugs, a 5-HT3 receptor antagonist, there was a granisetron together with corticosteroids, will be the control arm, and the experimental arm will be the granisetron together with the corticosteroids as well as the rolapentin. And the study was significantly better in terms of the efficacy. It was shown on the presentations last year here at ASCO, at the MASC meeting, Multinational Association of Supportive Care in Cancer, as well as some of this data was presented at the ESMO meeting last year. Now, this particular aspect is looking at sure, we don't have so much nausea and vomiting, but let's see if it affects or not, or improves the quality of life of the patients. And basically, most of the endpoints looked at was particularly significant in terms of no nausea, improving quality of life, no vomiting, improving quality of life, or less nausea or less vomiting. And then when you combine them together, also was particularly positive on the patients with moderately emetogenic chemotherapy, but was also positive on a lot of the endpoints on the highly emetogenic chemotherapy.
So what follow-up work would you do based on these findings?
There are other settings or subtype of patients that you would like to see if this impact on quality of life. For example, we haven't done any work on multiple days of chemotherapy regimes. That's a very important area. There are some tumors you treated not with one day, with multiple days. So you will have to do studies looking at the quality of life of those patients if you control nausea and vomiting as a follow-up. It's also important to look at the high-dose chemotherapy with stem cell transplantation and to see if you improve the quality of life of those patients. Then it's also in pediatric tumors, adolescent tumors. It's a number of subsets that this current set of studies haven't looked at.
Very well. Thank you, Dr. Rapoport. Thanks for coming by and sharing your work with us.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Very good.